theory as consciousness and the subconscious is changing and the links between the two, and he'll be a considerable figure, as he is already, but I think he'll be in history, I really do. And so we're extremely privileged to have him down here. He's not doing many events at all, so I'm all the more pleased that he's come. Thank you for your patience again, and a big welcome to Colin Wilson.
Yes, I'm so sorry we're late. We just got stuck in a traffic jam outside London. I gather that Graham Hancock was here fairly recently. Was that last week?
No, for the previous book, Fingerprints of the Gods.
Fingerprints of the Gods, yeah. So if any of you were there for Graham's talk, I needn't sort of cover too much of that ground. Because what interested me so much was the way that this book seems to have, in a way, been a culmination of work I've been doing for the past 40 years. The Outsider came out 40 years ago, next Sunday, and really, looking back at this, it does seem something of a kind of anniversary. You see, when I started writing The Outsider, as you know, what interested me very much was basically the fact that so many men of genius of the 19th century had committed suicide or died in stupid accidents like Shelley, and generally been depressives. And all for the same reason, that they'd had these wonderful moods of extraordinary intensity when the universe had seemed such a wonderful place that they felt that no one could ever possibly want to die. The sort of mood in which Van Gogh painted that thing, The Starry Night, in which, you know, the whole of the sky seemed to turn into immense swirls of sheer vitality. And then you remember, less than a year after painting that, Van Gogh committed suicide and left a note saying, "Misery will never end." And this struck me as so typical. After these tremendous moods of great insight, we land back on the ground again and wake up the next morning feeling, what was all that about? It all seems to have been completely meaningless. And what I really wanted to know was which is true, the Starry Night or the suicide note? And is there a way of finding out which is true? Obviously, the only basic way would be to be able to induce in yourself moods of such tremendous intensity and happiness that you would have a chance, so to speak, to compare the two side by side. And unfortunately, this never seems to happen. Now, soon after The Outsider came out, though, I got a letter from an American professor of psychology called Abraham Maslow. And Maslow said that he got fed up with studying sick people because sick people talked about nothing but their sickness. And so he decided that he would look around for the healthiest people he could find. And he asked around among his friends, who's the healthiest person you know? And they put him onto various people. And he got together several dozen really exceptionally healthy people and studied them instead. And he quickly discovered something that nobody else had ever discovered, because nobody else had ever thought of studying healthy people, that all of these healthy people had with great frequency what he called peak experiences, experiences of sort of sheer bubbling happiness. These weren't mystical experiences, they were often perfectly ordinary events. And the one I quoted in this book is of a young mother watching her husband and children eating breakfast when she suddenly thought, my God, aren't I lucky, and went into the peak experience. A marine who'd been in the South Pacific for several years without seeing a woman, when he got back to base, saw a nurse, and instantly had a peak experience, because he said it suddenly struck him that women are different from men. He said, we assume that they're different, we take it for granted they're different, but in a certain sense, we don't really see that they're as totally different from men as cows are from horses. And he said it suddenly hit him with terrific impact as soon as he saw this. Now, that's what it's really all about. A sudden perception of something, almost as if you'd been looking at something in two dimensions. You know, they used to have those sort of glasses you put on that were red in one eye and green in the other, and then you look at these funny blurred photographs, and suddenly the blurred photographs go into three dimensions, and you actually see the tiger sticking its head out of the jungle. And this is what seems to happen in the peak experience. Quite suddenly, the ordinary flat two-dimensional world turns into three dimensions, and you suddenly see that women are different from men, and that we don't really understand this at all. Now, it seemed to me that Maslow had come closer than anybody else to getting down to the essence of what I was talking about in The Outsider, because obviously the peak experience is what Van Gogh experienced painting The Starry Night. So I said to Maslow, I went to lecture at his university in America, how can peak experiences be induced? And Maslow said, unfortunately, they can't. They come when they want to and they go when they want to. And there's nothing you can do about it in the meantime. Now, that struck me as totally defeatist, because it seemed to me that it ought to be possible to induce a peak experience at will, provided you knew the right mental mechanism. And what's more, Maslow gave me the clue, because what Maslow said was that when he began to talk to his students about peak experiences, they began to remember peak experiences that they'd had in the past that they'd kind of taken for granted. And for example, a young man who was working his way through college as a jazz drummer, suddenly one night at about 1 o'clock in the morning found that he was drumming so perfectly that he couldn't do a thing wrong and went into the peak experience. Now, as his students began to talk to one another about peak experiences, remembering peak experiences in the past, they began having peak experiences all the time. They'd, in a sense, found the secret of having peak experiences at will. You merely turn your mind in that direction, and it happens. And the mechanism, of course, is, in a sense, simple. You see, it has struck me that the basic problem with human beings is that we all have inside is a kind of robot that does things for us. So, for example, you learn to type painfully key by key, then the robot takes it over and types much quicker than you could. Or you learn to talk French word by word, and then suddenly the robot takes it over and talks French absolutely naturally, and so on. But unfortunately, the robot not only takes over the things we want him to take over, like typing and talking French, he takes over the things we don't want him to take over. So you listen to a piece of music that moves you deeply the first time you hear it, to the first two or three times, and then the fourth time the robot is listening instead of you, or with you, or you read some poem that moves you, or you go for a walk, and so on. And then you find that, you know, the fifth time you go for the same walk, the robot is walking alongside you, and you're really not getting the impact. Now, it seems to me that what we're getting here is perfectly simple. You could say that you are normally 50% robot and 50% what you might call real you. And normally these two are perfectly balanced. Now, when suddenly you go out on a spring morning and get that odd feeling, God, isn't everything wonderful, quite suddenly you jump up to 51% real you and 49% robot, and you get this feeling of being a real person. Now, on the other hand, when you get tired, the robot takes over quite naturally, switches in like a thermostat, and so you suddenly get home and can't remember driving home, simply because the robot has taken over the driving for you. Now, unfortunately, in the modern world, there are so many things that require a lot of robot that we're always letting the robot take over. And the trouble with the robot when he takes over is that he somehow prevents you from having the experience, and because you are not having the experience anymore, you tend to feel that things are a bit flat and boring. And when you think that things are a bit flat and boring, you cease to put any kind of effort into them. And because you cease to put any kind of effort into them, they look flat and boring. And because they look flat and boring, and so it goes on in negative feedback. Now, if you can be induced to put far more effort into anything, simply by making that curious effort of contraction, you remember Dr. Johnson said, the knowledge that he's to be hanged in a fortnight concentrates a man's mind wonderfully. And my other favourite story, of course, of Graham Greene and his Russian roulette. Do you remember that Green said that in his teens he became incredibly bored? He found himself going into a completely flat state in which everything looked grey and dull. He said he could look at a scene which he could see visually was beautiful, but he felt nothing whatever, just dead inside. And then he found in a corner cupboard a revolver belonging to his elder brother and took it out onto Berkhamsted Common and played Russian roulette. He put one bullet in the chambers, spun the chambers, pointed it at his head and pulled the trigger. And when there was just a click, he looked down the barrel and saw the bullet had now come into position. And he said he felt a terrific sense of happiness and relief and could suddenly see that the world was an absolutely wonderful place. And he actually did this six times. and unfortunately escaped death, because I think he's the lousiest novelist. But you can see there the mechanism of the peak experience. You see, he's got himself into this robotic state in which everything is flat and dull, and in which it's the robot living instead of him. Then he points the gun at his head, spins the chambers and pulls the trigger, and his whole being goes, "Argh!" And then there's just a click, and he goes, "Whew!" And what he's actually done is to bring his full attention far more fiercely than we do in any event in normal life. And it's this sudden contraction of the attention which causes the peak experience. And so I saw that I'd got something absolutely basic. Now, you may say, what has all this got to do with the Sphinx? But there was another problem connected with all this. You see, the thing is, we human beings are at the moment the most dominant race on Earth because we have such a highly efficient robot. By comparison, animals just don't have a robot on the same level. So part of the problem is that we have developed too much robot in order to cope. Now, what struck me as so peculiar was the way that man suddenly became human. We know that this happened over the last 500,000 years, which, you know, in geological time is the blink of an eyelid. What changed these apes into human beings so quickly? There occurred about 500,000 years ago what scientists call the brain explosion. The human brain doubled its volume in a fairly short time. And it seemed to me that there was a great mystery here. The other great mystery that struck me was that I'd always been deeply interested in religion. Believe it or not, The Outsider was intended basically as an argument in favour of religion, and it started off with a chapter about T. Hume, who was that philosopher that influenced T.S. Eliot so much, who was killed in the First World War, and who felt that the religious attitude is fundamentally, you know, the true attitude towards human existence. Now, this obsessed me to a great extent because it also seemed to me that, in a sense, the religious attitude is simply sort of waking up to what actually surrounds you, how wonderful everything is. Recently, I finished an enormous encyclopedia for Dorling Kindersley of sacred sites of the world. And again, looking through this, it strikes me that there's something very odd about human beings. Why is man the only religious animal? Why is he so obsessed with religion? According to the 19th century, this was because he heard the thunder and was afraid and sort of decided that the thunder was a god and so on. That is obviously totally untrue. It's due to some kind of other reason. Somebody I was talking to on a radio program today said to me in Cambridge that 2 weeks ago there was a service which was taken by a Mohammedan, but it was a Christian and a Mohammedan mixed service. And he said something very strange happened to that service. He said, "I suddenly got a weird feeling that an enormous gush of emotion," he said, "and oddly enough of willpower, was actually flowing through that building and literally transforming everything. Van Gogh's Starry Night." Somehow we can release something in us that transforms things, and it's inside us already. Now, that is what fascinated me so much. What caused man to change from an ape into a religious animal? Because obviously, by definition, in a certain sense, animals cannot be religious. It's obviously a sense of meaning outside you. So, this had been one of the basic questions that preoccupied me. Now, when a few years ago I heard about Shuala de Lubitsch declaring that the Sphinx had been weathered by water, he said, not rain actually, but by water rather than by windblown sand, and that this seemed to show that civilization was far, far older than we thought, because there's been no water in Egypt for thousands of years. And as you know, a man called John Anthony West was so fascinated by this that he persuaded a Boston geologist named Robert Schock to go and look at the Sphinx. And Schock, after a long time waiting until he got tenure at the university before he stuck his neck out, went and looked at the Sphinx and said, "Oh, yeah, sure, that's water weathering. It's quite distinct from wind weathering, which slices a sort of a long layers of different hardness, making them like a sort of layer cake, whereas when water runs down, it not only takes out the layers in between, but it causes cracks to appear right down. So it looks sort of like a series of buttocks side by side stuck out, and that's what the Sphinx looks like. And the Sphinx enclosure too, the sort of thing that surrounds the Sphinx, that the Sphinx was originally sliced out of. Well, Schock said that it looked to him as if this thing had to be at least 7,000 BC. Well, as you know, the pyramids are supposed to have been built in 2,500 BC. One of the great problems for Egyptologists is how Egyptian civilization rose to such an extent in such a brief period of time. I mean, ancient Egypt is supposed to have started around about 3,000 BC. Before that, there was nothing but a few nomads and a lot of desert. And then quite suddenly, you have this incredible civilization, not just the Sphinx and the pyramids and the temples, but an extraordinarily complex mathematics, a religious system, medicine, and so on and so forth. It's too quick. It happened too suddenly. So this had been one of the things that greatly preoccupied Schwaller, and he came up with the amazing statement that, of course, the reason was that survivors from Atlantis built the Sphinx. Now, as you know, Plato declared in the Timaeus that Atlantis had been destroyed round about 9,000 years before his time, which placed it sort of getting on for 9,600, 9,700, something like that. Now, it does seem that some enormous catastrophe occurred round about that time. About a month ago, there appeared a piece in the Sunday Times about a professor called Alexander Tolman in Vienna, who declares that he now has evidence that the Earth was struck by an enormous comet round about 12,000 years ago, which must have caused absolutely disastrous floods and other catastrophes. The Mayas and the Aztecs in Central and South America committed the sort of most appalling series of human sacrifices over thousands of years because they believed that the gods were likely to once again destroy the earth as they had once. And documents showing what they really believed, Maya documents for example, show that they believed that the sun was suddenly darkened, that some appalling catastrophe occurred, and that after this catastrophe a white god that they called Viracocha came to South America, and that from then on acted as a kind of saviour. Now, in the 19th century, a man called, a French abbé called Brasseur de Bourbourg, taught himself how to read Mayan documents from the last people who actually spoke the language, translated these, and came up with a translation that said that the civilization had been destroyed by some enormous catastrophe around about 9,700 BC, and that ever since then there had been this tremendous fear. He also, the same document is called the Troano Codex, goes on to say that it was after this that white people came to South America from the east. They call him also Quetzalcoatl, Contiki, and various other names. So this is what interested Graham Hancock so much. He actually went to investigate all this stuff. It all began to come together. Now you can see that this comment of Tolman's about the comet hitting the Earth seems to pull it together even more. Now, the question that really struck me as being so interesting, okay, supposing human civilization is thousands of years older than we think, supposing the Sphinx was built 10,500 BC, which is the main argument of my book, so what? What difference does it make to us? Well, it was when I really began to think about this, when I actually read Graham Hancock's Fingerprints of the Gods, which he lent to me in typescript, I thought, my God, how stupid, you know, I must give up my own book, because obviously he's said it all. Then I began to think more closely about this, and I began to see that in point of fact there was still a great deal to say. To begin with, the mentality of these ancient people an even simpler question, how did they raise 200 ton blocks to make the Sphinx temple in front of the Sphinx? We can't do it. We haven't got any cranes that are big enough to lift 200 tons. How did the ancient Egyptians do it? It struck me that you've got a very interesting practical problem there. And it was while thinking about this and about this whole problem of human evolution that things began to fall in place for me. And it suddenly seemed to me that I began to see the answers to questions I'd been asking for years. And that the most basic answer is this. We cannot even begin to conceive of the mentality of ancient man because we've changed so completely. In fact, that period when the pyramids were built, and they definitely were built round about 2500 BC, astronomical calculations and so on done by Robert Bovall using a computer seem to show that the shafts, the air shafts out of the King's Chamber, the Queen's Chamber, which point towards the belt of Orion and towards the star Sirius, would align exactly round about 2500, and there would have been no sense in building them at any other time. So the pyramids were built 2500 BC. And that seems to have been one of the most remarkable civilizations ever known. Everybody who's written about the ancient Egyptians, the contemporaries who wrote about them, said that they were the happiest civilization ever. And in a certain sense, you can understand that. There they were in the Nile Valley, which is kind of tube, with this river that flooded once a year and made their land fertile, high mountains on either side which kept them protected from enemies, and apart from that, a sort of almost perfect climate. And so, the ancient Egyptians had this sense of being favoured by the gods. Not only that, in a certain sense, they believed that they were gods. They believed that ancient Egypt was the precise reflection on the ground of the heavens above. An exact reflection. And that, according to Graham Hancock and Robert Bovall, is why the pyramids were built in this rather peculiar sequence. Robert Bovall had gone along to the Cairo Museum and seen a photograph on the wall of the pyramids taken from the air. And he found it very difficult to understand why. First of all, you've got the big square Great Pyramid. Next to that along here, you've got the second pyramid of Chephren. And the two of them are more or less aligned. You could draw a line straight through the corner of the Great Pyramid, a second corner, first corner of Chephren, and so on down. And then suddenly, the other pyramid of Mycerinus, Menkaura, is much smaller than the other two and way off this straight line down. He couldn't see why they'd built them in such a peculiar way. Until one night when in the desert, he happened to stand on a sand dune when he couldn't sleep, and a friend of his showed him how to recognize the constellation of Orion. And looking at the belt of Orion, you know, Orion shaped like an hourglass, and across its middle there are three stars. And he suddenly saw that these three stars across the belt of Orion are a precise reflection of the pyramids. And it suddenly hit him why they'd chosen to make the pyramids in this way. Orion represented the god Osiris. And the pyramids, in a certain sense, were supposed to represent on the ground those three stars, the home of Osiris in the sky. But there was an interesting problem. The stars, all the stars in the sky, go up and down every 26,000 years due to a thing called precession of the equinoxes, which is due to that slight wobble on the Earth's axis. And not only do they go up and down, but they turn slightly as they do it, as if attached to the hand of a clock. Which naturally means that a thing like the hourglass shape of Orion does not reflect, in fact, the pyramids on the ground, because, you know, when it's up here halfway, the three stars are in a slight... they're not reflected down below in the mirror. The only time the stars are reflected exactly is when Orion is at the bottom of its cycle near the horizon, which happened in 10,500 BC. They are totally convinced that what happened was that refugees from some lost civilization came to Egypt, built the Sphinx around about 10,500, facing towards the constellation of Leo, the Sphinx itself being a kind of lion, and also laid out the plan of the three pyramids. That they may even have built half of Chephren's pyramid, because the lower half is very obviously different from the top half in being built of these enormous blocks. Why did they wait 8,000 years? Well, according to this latest book of Robert Bovall and Graham Hancock, because they had to wait for a certain configuration in the sky when Osiris would, so to speak, return home. Now, it's too complicated for me to explain here, and I do explain it in the book. But that basically is their belief, that in fact the ancient priests built the Sphinx in 10,500, and they built the Great Pyramid as a kind of climax of their history 8,000 years later. Now, again, why should that be particularly significant? This puzzled me. And then, little by little, the answers began to fall into place one by one. The Swiss psychologist Jean Piaget, looking at certain tools made by man 330,000 years ago, said that the men who made these tools were as intelligent as a modern man. More than 300,000 years ago. If they were as intelligent as a modern man, why didn't they use it? Why didn't they do something with it? Why didn't they build civilization? The answer is, of course, that you don't do anything with your intelligence if you are more or less contented and you are leading the same kind of life that you led yesterday and the day before that. You need a stimulus, a kind of force like a kick to make you do something. So I found myself wondering, what actually happened then to human beings? You see, we know that probably the first so-called human creature, Lucy, was found in Abyssinia and appears to date about 3.5 million years ago. We know that Australopithecus, again this sort of African ape man, southern ape man, seems to be about 2 million years old, but these are apes, basically. It's not until you get down to round about 500,000 years ago that you get Peking man, and you suddenly begin to get evidence that Peking man was a cannibal. Now, most animals are not cannibals. For example, you can't persuade a dog to eat dog meat. It just will not happen. The reason that man became a cannibal was that he did it for religious reasons, ritual reasons. He believed that eating the enemy, you actually take over his vitality and his qualities. And there is evidence that man was doing this 500,000 years ago. That seems to me to be the real beginning. In other words, 500,000 years ago, man was already, in a sense, a religious creature. And yet these creatures were unable to communicate in our sense. And yet you can't have a religion, a ritual, without some kind of communication, verbal communication. I think that that is what started this rolling evolution of man. I think, therefore, that this comment of Piaget's that man was as intelligent 330,000 years ago is, again, you know, acceptable. But what made this great change come about? Why did man suddenly become a totally different creature? We know that this appeared to happen something like 50,000 years ago when our ancestor Cro-Magnon man appeared on Earth. We also know that his predecessor, Neanderthal man, whom he may well have wiped out, had in fact a bigger brain than we have. His brain was often twice the size of a modern human being. Moreover, we know that he was a highly religious creature, Neanderthal man. We know that he cared for the old people in his tribe, and we know from the sort of flowers and things that he put in the graves, and also from curious discs that looked like the sun, that he must have carved sun discs. He was a religious creature, and yet he didn't go any further. The only thing Neanderthal man did was to invent the bow and arrow. What made this great change? Well, the clue is on the walls of caves like Lascaux, where you have drawings of shamans leading some kind of peculiar dance and often wearing animal skins and with horns on the forehead. These are found in many of these ancient French caves, and the oldest so far is about 35,000 years ago. Now, it sounds as if he was simply wishful thinking and hoping that by performing some kind of magical ceremony, he was going to lure these animals into his traps when he went out hunting the following day. We know this because investigating modern Aboriginal tribes, we discover they still do the same thing. But was he such a fool that he continued to perform these rituals when they didn't work? I think the answer is they did work. I've quoted in there a piece from one of Jacquetta Hawkes' books, in which she talks about an anthropologist called Frobenius, and he said to the pygmies, "We really need to get some more meat." And the pygmy said, "Oh yes, but we can't do that today. We've got to perform this ceremony first." And Frobenius got up very early in the morning and crept to the hilltop and watched them perform a peculiar ceremony in which they drew the antelope in the dust and then fired an arrow which hit the antelope precisely in the neck. And they performed various rituals, and off they went and killed a number of antelopes by hitting them precisely in the neck. Quite clearly, they felt that the ceremony was of immense importance. I also love to quote a thing that I quoted in my book, The Occult, from Pattern of Islands by Sir Arthur Grimble, that business about the calling of the porpoises. Do you remember the episode in which Grimble says that when he was commissioner on the Gilbert Islands in the Pacific, he always wanted to see this porpoise calling, which he assumed to be a total superstition, until one day they said, "Okay, come on, it's happening today." So he was taken over the bay and introduced to a big fat man who was the porpoise caller, and the fat man then disappeared into his hut and went to sleep. And a long, long day went past, and Grimble was convinced that nothing would happen until suddenly the fat man came running out of his hut saying, "Okay, okay, they're coming." And they all rushed down to the beach, and dozens, hundreds of porpoises were swimming in from the sea and swimming onto the beach. The natives went into the sea and helped them ashore by putting their hands underneath them and so on, until the beach was littered with porpoises, which then lay there perfectly contentedly as the tide went out and left them to die. And of course they had lots of meat. According to the porpoise caller, he had to go into a dream, and then he went out to sea and invited the porpoises to come to dinner. And he didn't explain they were to be the meal. And apparently this works. Now, that sounds so peculiar that you know it's difficult to grasp until we suddenly realise that in fact ancient man has always had these capacities, so-called magical capacities. But he actually had them perfectly naturally. He felt them. You know, I discovered years ago that I could douse. I was taken down to a site where there were standing stones in Cornwall called the Merry Maidens, and a dowser friend shoved the dowsing rod, which was made of two strips of corset, tied with cotton at the end, into my hand and said, "Go on, try." And I said, "No, it's no good. I'm completely ESP thick. I can't do any of these things." And he said, "Go on, try." So I took hold of the dowsing rod, and he made me twist the ends like that so it had a spring on it. And then I approached the stone, and the dowsing rod went zoomp. And I thought I'd done it myself by changing my grip. So I approached the stone from the other side, and the dowsing rod went zoomp. And when I'd done this about a dozen times, I realised that the dowsing rod was as accurate as a voltmeter in a current of electricity. It was picking up something. On the very big stones, it was very powerful. In the middle of the circle, it was tremendously powerful. And yet, I couldn't feel a damn thing. All I knew was that when I walked across the circle, the dowsing rod twisted like a living thing in my hands. Now, Australian Aborigines can do it without a dowsing rod. And what's more, they can feel the water there, which is certainly more than I could do. And the reason is that we Westerners have become left-brainers. We are living in one half of our brain. We are not living in the whole brain as these people were. Now, I think that what happened to Cro-Magnon man was this. I think that at a certain point, he discovered, as Neanderthal man probably had also discovered, that he could lure prey simply by performing a kind of magical religious ritual before. I think that the person who led that ritual, the priest or shaman, would therefore automatically become the leader sooner or later. And so that sooner or later you had shamans, either male or female, I think very often they were female priestesses, becoming the leader of a group. And I think then you got a completely different thing from anything that man had been before. Unlike the leader of a wolf pack, which is merely the leader because it happens to be the most dominant, suddenly you have these people regarding this person as someone with supernatural powers, when indeed, in a certain sense, he did have. From then on, I think you've got a very interesting and peculiar situation. rather like Germany under Adolf Hitler, you can see that when a people is actually united by someone, even a madman, they become capable of sort of quite interesting things. Quite suddenly they're gripped by a kind of idealism. You can also see the same kind of thing with religious nutty messiahs like this man David Koresh, you know, whose people were all sort of burned to death at Waco a couple of years ago. Once people are totally united and believe totally in something, they're capable of quite different things than they are normally. I think that that is what happened with Cro-Magnon man around about 50,000 years ago. And that as soon as the leader became a kind of priest-king, he united them in a way that meant that they were suddenly using their intelligence instead of merely being intelligent. I've often felt, you know, that this question of using your intelligence is very important. I was interviewed this afternoon by an Irishman who was absolutely brilliant, and I've often felt, you know, that how naturally clever both the Irish and the Scots are. And yet, in a funny sort of way, they never seem to use the intelligence for any practical purpose. They never really seemed, the Scots particularly, that whenever, you know, I've done this kind of thing with Scots, they're so brilliant, they're way ahead of me, they can see your point long before you make it. And yet somehow, you know, I mean, I won't say they're a race of drunken bums, no, I've just said it, but they really do have that tendency not to really settle down and do something. And this, I think, is because they're, in a sense, much more right-brainers than the Anglo-Saxons are. And it's because they are much more right-brainers that they have this ability to leap straight to a point far ahead of you. And yet, you can see that being right-brainers also takes away any sort of the plodding drive and purpose that the Anglo-Saxon tends to possess. Oh, we haven't got too many Scots and Irish in this. You see, what you might call collective consciousness, the kind of consciousness that the ancient Egyptians had, has great disadvantages and great advantages. One of its great advantages is that you can do things that seem absolutely impossible. At the beginning of this book, I've quoted this strange story about calculating prodigies. There are two complete nuts in a New York mental home who can sit together swapping 20-figure primes. You know that a prime number is a number you can't get by multiplying two numbers together, like 7 is a prime, 13 is a prime. Well, some primes are so big that there's no way of knowing whether they are primes except by dividing every other number into them. Even a computer has to do it that way. Well, Azira Coben, who was a calculating boy in the 19th century, was asked whether a particular 10 or 11 figure prime created by Fermat was in fact a prime, and he thought for a moment and said, no, it's divisible by 641. It can't be done! A computer can't do it. And there are these two twins sitting in a New York mental home swapping 20-figure primes. And yet they're both dotty. You can see that there's a sense in which they're seeing the whole number field from the air. They're using a completely different sense from anything that we possess now. We've learned to do things in a different way, in a plodding sort of way, but in a sense it's a far more reliable way. Now, another thing I've quoted in that book is even more interesting. Bob Ardrey told me, Robert Ardrey, who wrote African Genesis, that with Raymond Dart one day, he was looking down at what looked like a beautiful flower, a sort of lilac, beautifully coloured, that turned towards the end into a lovely green, that Dart waved his hand over this thing and it turned into a swarm of little flies called flatted bugs, which all flew around like that. Then when they realised there was nothing wrong, they settled back on the twig, crawled over one another's backs, and within 5 minutes they'd regrouped into an absolutely perfect flower, a flower that does not exist in nature. Now, according to Darwin, the reason that animals evolve is that the fittest live and the less fit die. But it happens with individuals. It doesn't happen with groups. Can you think of any Darwinian way in which those flatted bugs could have formed themselves into a flower? It just can't be done. Somehow, they were a group, they were a single mind, and they were doing it all together. And that's the great advantage of collective consciousness. The ancient Egyptians were a kind of collective consciousness. And what's more, in a funny sense, they were the highest thing that the human race had achieved by that time. What had started with Cro-Magnon man and his shamans had, by the time of the ancient Egyptians, evolved into a sort of unified collective civilization. And what's more, a civilization that sort of, like the flatted bugs, had a peculiar ability to do things that cannot be done. Or like the calculating prodigies. One of the things they did was to raise 200-ton blocks. The next question, of course, is how? And there you come across something very difficult. I've quoted in there a book by a man called Kevin Kelly called Out of Control, which I came across by complete chance when I'd almost finished this book. Kelly describes how at a computer conference in San Diego a couple of years ago, the audience of 5,000 was divided into two halves, and they were made to play a kind of electronic ping pong, with each of the two halves, 2,500 each, behaving as if they were one person. And they had to do this by turning bats that were coloured on one, red on one side and green on the other, towards a giant camera, and it all came up on a huge screen. Well, it took them precisely 5 minutes for 2,500 people to begin playing electronic ping pong as if they were one single person. They then went on to perform another interesting experiment in which the 5,000 people of the audience were asked to combine together to bring in a simulated plane to land, you know, the kind of thing that pilots use to train. And after a couple of false landings, the whole 5,000 made the perfect landing with a plane, like one person. And what's more, they were all so delighted with this feat, they made the plane loop the loop, all together. Now, have you ever seen a flock of birds, the way it turns in the air simultaneously without any obvious communication, or a shoal of fishes suddenly turning in the water in another direction? This is what we're talking about. We're talking about a whole group of people behaving like one organism, and we still do it. We can still do it. As they prove, we can do it within 5 minutes of training. Now, the obvious question is, well, okay, but how did they raise 200-ton blocks? Well, there, you know, I'd have to go into sort of what you may feel complete fantasy. I recently did an introduction to a book on the paranormal, and a long chapter by a Russian parapsychologist contains an account of various people who are very good at psychokinesis, including a Russian film director called Boris Yermolaev. And one of the things Yermolaev can do is this. He can take a matchbox and hold it between his two hands like that, and he concentrates terribly hard until he really sweats. The sweat rolls down his forehead, and then very carefully he separates his hands, and the matchbox remains hanging in the air and remains for something like 40 seconds before it falls to the ground. Often it falls to the ground immediately and he has to start all over again. But when asked how he does it, he said, well, I kind of put my mind into the matchbox and persuade it to stay there. Now, imagine that group at San Diego trying to do the same kind of thing. Supposing you told them to build a pyramid. The Japanese tried it a few years ago and found that they couldn't do it. They just, with all our modern technology, could not build a model of the Great Pyramid even on a smaller scale. But I imagine that what happened is something like this. A vast body of workmen, of ancient Egyptian workmen, got together with a priest leading them, chanting words of power and all the rest of it. They didn't realize they were doing anything peculiar. They were told to move a 200-ton block, and they probably did it by, you know, straightforward means, ropes and all that kind of thing. Only they did it sort of with a peculiar unity, like those people in San Diego, and they moved the 200-ton block. And they thought it was perfectly natural to do it because the gods were aiding them, and so on. Now, what happened after 2500 BC was that the Egyptians went to pieces. Within 200 years, they'd lost that ability to build pyramids like that. Their pyramids are suddenly messes. And when you read ancient Egyptian literature, you can see why. Quite suddenly, an enormous self-doubt has entered. And it's this strange self-doubt, which was really a matter of individuation. They were turning into individuals. They'd got this wonderful civilization, like no civilization on earth ever before, And suddenly they were saying to themselves self-consciously, my God, aren't we lucky, isn't it wonderful, and so on. Individuality was creeping in. You get much more moral concern for the individual in subsequent Egyptian literature. But that ability of the collective disappears. And I think that it disappeared completely by something like 1200 BC, and I'll explain why in that book, citing a man called Julian James and his book about consciousness and the bicameral mind, which unfortunately I don't have time to go into. But what it really means is that we have become left-brainers. We have two compartments for our brain, and we live in the left side. Very briefly, let me say this, although most of you already know it. If you took off the top of your head and looked at your brain, it would look like a walnut with two halves. And the middle bit is called the corpus callosum. It's kind of thick knot of nerves that joins the two halves of the brain. Now, they discovered that by severing the corpus callosum, they can actually stop people having epileptic attacks because it stops the storm getting over from one half to the other. They then discovered that when they'd severed this middle half of the brain, people began to behave like two people. As it is, as you know, the right side of the body is connected to the left half of the brain, and the left half of the body to the right side of the brain, and so on. And the same is roughly true of your eyes, or anyway, of your visual fields. Won't go into that too much. But what it amounts to is that if you show a left brain, a split brain patient, an orange with the left eye, and an apple with the right eye, so that one eye cannot see what the other one is seeing, and you say to him, what have you just been looking at? He will reply, an orange. If you say, write with your left hand what you've just been looking at, he will write, apple. And if you say, don't let him see what he's written, and say, what have you just written, he'll say, orange. If you show him a dirty postcard with the right half of his brain, he'll blush. If you say, why are you blushing, he says, I don't know. You have two people living in your head. And the person who's now listening to me is the person living in the left side of your brain. And living a centimetre away, there's a total stranger, a second person. Now, that second person is the person who made the dowsing rod twist in my hand. And unfortunately, I don't know him really very well, because I'm an absolute typical left-brainer. But on the other hand, being a writer, I do get moments when I suddenly begin to understand what it's all about. You see, if you're a writer, you start by trying to put words down on paper because you suddenly get flashes of wonderful ideas, you know, particularly as a teenager, you pull them onto paper, then you read what you've written the next morning and it's absolute rubbish. It's like squashed flies all over the paper. And you get a feeling, oh my God, you get those wonderful feelings, but they cannot be captured in words. Now you see, what is happening is that in point of fact, the left brain is the side of your brain that deals with language and with calculation, with that kind of thing. The right side of your brain deals with intuition and inspiration, and also with shapes of things. A person who's had bad damage can no longer, for example, even draw a three-leaf clover. He draws the leaves side by side. You lose all sense of shape. Now, these two people nevertheless do cooperate to a certain extent. And if you're a writer, you go on trying because you've got nothing else to do. And one day, you wake up the next morning and it's still there. It's there on the page, what you put there the night before. And you think, marvellous, hooray! Because what has really happened is that the left brain, that's you, has caught these weird ideas as they came up from the other side and translated them into language. You know, Mozart said that his ideas came walking into his head out of nowhere and all he had to do was write them down. Where did they come from? His right brain. Who wrote them down? Mozart, who lived in his left brain. Now, you get into sudden moods when you're writing, when you feel, my God, this is going so well. And what is really happening is that the right brain is flinging up ideas, the left brain is catching them and turning them into words, and then the right brain says, yes, yes, that's what I meant. And the left brain says, oh, really, thank you very much. And the next lot turns into words even more perfectly. And suddenly you've got a kind of tennis match going between the two halves of the brain, in which they're collaborating absolutely perfectly. And in those moments, you get most of a feeling that you ever get in your life of being a kind of unified being, one single person, and no longer stranded in your sort of analytical intellect. Now, it seems to me that this is a possibility that exists all the time. I could see years ago that it's possible. In fact, I quickly found, actually make use of this person in the right brain by simply asking him to do things for me. And for example, an Italian film producer used to get me to go to London
and work on absolutely shitty film scripts, so awful that, you know, nobody else had touched them. But he paid me $10,000 for locking me in a hotel room for 2 days. And at the end of working on some awful script, the most god-awful script I've ever tried to work on, he locked me in the room for a week that time and paid me $20,000. And towards the end of the week, I was beginning to feel, oh God, no ideas would come whatsoever. I managed to get the thing started, and one night I went to bed feeling so low and so totally depressed that I felt, you know, I'm going to have to tell him I can't do this. And then I suddenly remembered what I've just been saying about the right brain. And I said, oh, come on, old right brain, for Christ's sake, get moving, do something. And as soon as I said that to myself, I felt a curious sense of relaxation and peace. I went into a lovely deep sleep. I woke up the next morning about 7 o'clock, got down to my typewriter, didn't feel any particular inspiration, but began typing, and suddenly it began to come, and suddenly ideas were tripping over one another, and by the time Dino's secretary came in the late afternoon to pick up the script, I'd actually finished it, and I handed it to her and said, go and ask him if I can go home now, will you? And as I went back in his car to the station, I sort of felt, thank you, old right brain, you've done it again. It's simply the recognition that it's there, that it exists. And can you see that that's why Maslow's students began having peak experiences all the time? The peak experience is, again, that experience of unity when the right and the left come together. And once you know that the right is there to catch you, once you trust it, so to speak, you are able to get this experience of unity fairly easily because you trust it. You know, when we were kids, we used to play a game that you put your hands by your sides like that and you fell backwards into the hands of someone who was waiting behind you to catch you. But you never really did it very comfortably because you always suspected that he'd stand back and let you fall on your back. Well, the point is, the right brain will never let you fall on your back. It will always catch you. Now, this seems to me to be an absolutely basic answer. You see, having seen that the ancient Egyptians appeared to have this right brain civilization in which they felt a total unity, the next obvious question was, well, what about us? We appear to be sort of getting worse and worse. We appear to be getting into worse and worse difficulties and problems. And then suddenly recognize that, in fact, an audience in San Diego can actually get back into the Egyptian state of mind in exactly 5 minutes, that we still possess all of those powers that we did once possess. And as soon as you begin to look at this thing from a bird's eye view and see the way that human evolution has taken place over the last 500,000 years, you suddenly begin to see more precisely what has happened to us and precisely why it has happened to us, and that we are, in a sense, in one of the most interesting positions in human history at this moment. I've always believed that man is on the point of an evolutionary leap to a higher phase. That feeling that the outsider got, that the world is an absolutely wonderful place in which you would never want to die, that feeling is fundamentally true. And that the outsiders who committed suicide because they felt it was untrue were making a great mistake. Now, you can see that we are living in a deeply pessimistic civilization. You can see why I detest someone like Graham Greene, for example. The whole orientation, the whole sort of negativity, the whole feeling that, you know, we're living in a pretty lousy world and all suffering from original sin and there's nowhere we can go. This kind of thing has become so much a part of our Western mentality that it's very difficult to escape. And yet you can see how close we are to a solution. As, you know, it's waiting there to catch us, so to speak. As soon as we can begin to see the actual pattern from ancient man down to the present and see why we've got into our present position, and then realize that indeed we are very fortunate to have got into our present position, what we've done is to achieve a kind of individual consciousness, which means that periodically we produce Leonardos and Beethovens and Einsteins. That's what is really necessary for evolution. Not a lot of bugs that would crawl around and create a perfect flower on a branch. We appear to have lost something very important, and yet, as I've just tried to show you, we haven't lost it at all. It's there. Is sort of, you know, waiting for us just around the corner. And just as I was finishing this book, I suddenly saw that, in a sense, I finally solved the problem that I set out for the first time in The Outsider 40 years ago. That, in a certain, I won't say I've come full circle, but for the first time I've seen a real solution, and really seen this solution in historical terms. I better shut up now, Andrew. And if anyone wants to ask questions, I'd be happy to do them.
Well, yes.
And your freedom. And some of them came up to me afterwards and said, well, what do we do with our freedom? You can see that in a certain sense, I've handed you this thing. It's a you see, I'd always asked exactly that question. Look, let me try to put it more accurately. We know that you can do it as Graham Greene did it. In other words, what do we do? Okay, play Russian roulette. That'll do it. But it's a bit dangerous. Now, the answer really lies in Dr. Johnson's comment about concentration. All my life, I've been subject to boredom. I've been subject to these moods in which, you know, suddenly everything appears to be flat and grey, when an hour before everything had seemed wonderful, or the day before. I shall be 65 in a month's time. What I've discovered in that time, and indeed over the past few years, is that by an intense act of concentration, I can transform the present moment. I've learned to some extent the trick of creating peak experiences at will by an intense act of concentration. An old chap called Brownrigg wrote to me about 20 years ago, and I found his letter the other day. He said a very interesting thing. He said, the face is the gearbox of the soul. Use your face, he said, and he was talking about breathing, and you'll find that you can do the most amazing things with your emotions. Well, I tried it. Actually, if you try twisting and contorting your face and all the rest of it, notice what happens, for example, when you itch really badly and then you scratch yourself. You're focused so totally and completely on the itch, particularly if there are people around and you can't scratch for the time being and you've got to let go on itching until you can get alone. When you finally scratch, you are focused so totally upon the itch that your mind is like a laser, and for the first time you really experience something. Now, clearly, this is the beginning of the answer. When I was lecturing at an American college about 30 years ago, there was a very handsome young teacher, and I was very jealous of him because there was a girls' college, and they were all in love with him. And he struck me as exceptionally stupid. And one day, when I'd been giving a lecture to these girls and talking about the peak experience, this teacher said to me, oh yeah, I can do that. And I said, what? And he said, yes, I can do that. And I said, how? And he said, oh, it's very simple. He said, when I was a young boy, my mother was very impatient, and if I fidgeted in church, she would get angrier and angrier, and then finally would send me to bed without any supper. And so he said, one day I was itching like mad in church. I itched so badly I wanted to scratch, and yet I realized if I scratched, no supper. And then he said, as I concentrated on this itch, trying frenziedly to make it itch less, suddenly it turned into a wonderful feeling of ecstatic happiness. He said, and I can do it all the time. He said, whoo! He said, there, I did it then. So once you've got that kind of trick, it can be done instantaneously, but you've got to know that you can do it. And it's to be, think of that question of scratching an itch. You see, you might say that the answer to his peak experience was, when you itch, don't scratch. But no, what he'd really done, you can see, was focus his mind so totally on the itch that the focusing of the mind caused the ecstatic experience. You reach a certain point of focus and boom, off you go. Now, we do most of our things without really focusing on them. When you're really hungry and you settle down to a good meal, then you focus. When you're really thirsty and you drink something, then you focus. But otherwise, you don't focus your mind. Now, what I'm saying is, that habit of focus I have discovered produces the peak experience. I get up at 6 o'clock every morning and go and make myself tea and go back to bed, and as often as not, I sit giving myself peak experiences for 5 minutes by merely focusing the mind intently. And what happens is a curious feeling of warmth and happiness that floods through the whole body. This seems to me to be the beginning of what I'm talking about.
Did you decide if that teacher was stupid after all this?
No, I obviously...
changed your view.
Yeah, it was brilliant in a sense.
So you must be a very healthy person now.
Yeah, I'm a jolly sort of person, as you can see, and I always have been. And I think that that's partly because with this sort of working class childhood and background, my dad worked throughout the 30s for sort of about £3 a week. And the result was that although I was a very intelligent child and always got top marks at school, there was no chance of getting to university or anything of the sort. And when I left school at 16, I immediately had to go and work in a factory, and I hated it. And I really felt, you know, that I was stuck on a treadmill for the rest of my life. The person I admired most was Einstein, and I wanted to be another Einstein, and there I was working in a factory. And this was how I came to create this whole idea of outsiders, misfits, and who don't really fit in at all, because obviously I felt very strongly that I was one. But the fact that I had then to try, remembering William Blake's comment, the angel who presided at my birth said, "Little creature born of joy and mirth, go, love without the help of anything on earth." And I realized in my teens that what I got to do was to achieve a state of inner contentment without the help of anything on earth, even if I was going to be stuck in a factory for the rest of my life. I used to send off things to publishers and they'd always come back and cause me tremendous disappointment. But a day came when I suddenly thought, well, so what? If you write books and stick them on a shelf in manuscript, at least you've done something with your life, even if they never see print. And funny enough, almost as soon as I'd really made up my mind to that, my first book was accepted on the strength of half of the book. That was The Outsider. And, you know, quite suddenly I found that my whole life had changed. But it had been a really grim and lousy struggle since the age of 16 to the age of 24 when The Outsider came out. I still, for years afterwards, continued to have nightmares that I was back working in a factory. Now, I think anybody who's really had to pull their cart out of the mud with non-stop effort develops a certain sort of jolliness of disposition, develops a sense that, you know, you can actually win. And this has always stuck with me very closely. You notice that major writers like Dickens, like Bernard Shaw, have been people who've had tremendous difficulty, like H.G. Wells, whereas the people who've been able to get a fairly easy start, like John Galsworthy in Evelyn Waugh, are very good writers, but they don't rise to greatness simply because they've got the cart out of the mud a bit too easily. I've got this theory that you really need to tug like mad to get your cart out of the mud.
Yes, when you were talking about the ancient Egyptians and the collective consciousness idea, I wasn't clear on what the disadvantages were. I could see what the advantages were, what they could do. What is it, the idea of sacrificing individuality in a way?
Yes, basically, as I'm saying, you can't imagine an ancient Egyptian Beethoven, although the architect of the step pyramid, Imhotep, came pretty close to being exactly that and was fatally turned into a god by the Egyptians, a rare kind of freak. And now we tend to produce extraordinary individuals all the time, and when The Outsider came out, I suddenly found that I was getting 20 letters a day, all beginning, "Dear Mr. Wilson, I'm an outsider." But it suddenly made me aware that there are thousands and thousands of people in our civilization who are in this position, who really are above average intelligence, above average drive and so on, above our average sensitivity, and that all these things tend to work to their disadvantage. And what I wanted above all was, how would you create a civilization that, so to speak, was good for outsiders, that gave people a real chance to express themselves and do what was inside them? And then I went to America to teach, and one of the things I was forced to teach was creative writing. And I quickly discovered that, you know, teaching people how to be creative wasn't a good idea. That the problem is that it's like putting fertilizer on weeds. They simply spring up. In order to be a good creative writer, you have to go through certain problems and torments and difficulties, and then gradually you learn to be a good creative writer. And to have a teacher teaching you how to be creative is somehow a contradiction in terms.
What's your own, if you don't mind sharing it with us, attitude or view on religion? Have you taken up a form of religion or just the meditation for your peak experiences?
Oh,
and
no.
Can I also ask something else at the same time so I get the chance? Anything that you might know about giants? I know you mentioned them in the occult, but I'd love to know what your view is about giants.
Giants. Now, as to religion, obviously, when I was very young, I thought of entering a monastery. because I felt that that would be the only way to get out of a factory and to be allowed to devote my mind totally and entirely to the kind of things that deeply interested me. In fact, when The Outsider came out, I didn't need to enter a monastery anymore, and then I moved to Cornwall, and I've lived in the middle of nowhere. But then, as you know, what happened after The Outsider, it came out on the same day as John Osborne's Look Back in Anger. I literally woke up to find myself famous on the morning of the 26th of May, 1956. I mean, the phone began to ring, I was on television and radio and God knows what within 24 hours of all this. But of course, all of this absurd business, and then that they labelled as angry young men, when obviously I'm not particularly angry about anything, made the critics so detestors that within something like 6 months I was almost unmentionable. And suddenly life became sort of fairly difficult. And then my second book, Religion and the Rebel, appeared and was slaughtered by the critics. And in a sense, it was a great relief, because I'd found that being successful was a vertiginous kind of experience. It made you too self-conscious. You were thinking about, you know, your next book and whether it would be successful and all the rest of it. Now suddenly nobody gave a damn. And luckily, I was published in enough countries to be just about able to make a living. I've never made a lot of money. I'm sort of still more or less broke. And, you know, I've lived off an overdraft ever since The Outsider came out. But enough money keeps trickling in from different countries to sort of, you know, keep us floating along. And I found that this is, in a way, the correct way to live. It means that I've concentrated entirely upon my books, concentrated entirely upon my ideas, and done it sort of, as it were, completely as you should do it, on your own, working in the dark. As to giants in St. Michael's Mount, I went down to look at a strange place underneath the floor where they'd found a body of a man 8 feet tall. And it seems fairly obvious that literally there were giants of a kind in Cornwall, enormously tall people. And there is evidence that there have been such people all over the world. In Java, for example, there seem to have been about 9 feet tall in Java. And so the legend of giants seems to me to be completely accurate. That curious Knut Horbiger, who believed that a number of moons have crashed onto the Earth over the course of evolution, believe that when the moon gets so close to the Earth, it counteracts gravity, and then people grow to an enormous height. And so the Bible saying there were giants in the Earth in those days is absolutely accurate. But since Orbiger also believed that the moon is made of ice, and they've now proved that it's not, I feel that not too much importance can be attached to his theory of giants.
Can I ask a question? It seems to me what you're saying is the right brain is a lot more optimistic, go-getting. The left brain is perhaps a lot more reserved, calculating, nervous of taking risks. Now, do you think there's any connection between that and what we've seen with the economy in the last 10 years, where perhaps there were people a lot more optimistic in the late 80s, going and buying houses perhaps, which they felt they could pay off, you could take out mortgages, and now there's a lot more reserve. Do you think that could be a national shift from right brain to left brain?
No, I don't think it happens in the short run in that way. I mean, obviously what went wrong with the economy was that Nigel Lawson did sort of various awful things that have caused us to collapse into this present state. But, you know, like the housing business, I mean, he was really responsible for the whole of that collapse in the housing market.
But it's people's perceptions, isn't it?
Yes, I don't think, as I say, that it happens over the short term. What does tend to happen is that people have to struggle against tremendous difficulties by struggling, create a kind of inner concentration, and when you create a kind of inner concentration, things go right. The way to solve problems is in some strange way to focus so completely and entirely upon the problem that you concentrate like that. I also believe that when you do that, you cause weird synchronicities to happen. I believe that Jung's whole idea of synchronicity is perfectly true, and I describe in that book again the way that at various times in my life, really, that whole book has been written on a series of synchronicities, like John West writing to me out of the blue when I'd never met him, saying, "Are you interested in this whole business of the Age of the Sphinx?" when I decided to use his theory in a film script. The strangest synchronicity of all I tell in that book, a friend of mine called Jacques Vallée, who writes books about flying saucers, had told me what he thinks to be one of the oddest synchronicities ever. He was investigating a cult in Los Angeles called the Cult of Melchizedek, who was a biblical prophet. And he was trying to find out more about who was Melchizedek, but apparently there's nothing on Melchizedek in the encyclopedias. And Jacques was going around looking for information about Melchizedek, and his taxi driver took him to Los Angeles Airport, and he asked her, as a lady, for a receipt, and she signed the receipt M. Melchizedek. So I thought, oh, that's interesting. There must be lots of Melchizedeks around in Los Angeles. So I looked through the Los Angeles phone directory, which is this fat, one Melchizedek, his taxi driver, and he said, it's as if you put a notice up on a kind of universal notice board, wanted Melchizedeks. And then along comes this girl and says, how about me? And no, that's not what I want, you're a taxi driver. And anyway, having finished writing this in an encyclopedia of unsolved mysteries, which I was writing at the time, I then got up and proceeded to go out for my walk, to take my dogs for a walk on the cliff. And as I got up, I noticed in the camp bed in my basement a book lying among the strewn books on it, which I hadn't really noticed before, called You Are Condemned to Life. I knew that I'd bought this thing because I'd had it rebound. It had been a paperback. So I took it upstairs and tossed it on the bed to read when I came home from my walk. When I came home, I opened it and found myself looking at a page headed Cult of Melchizedek, a letter from the founder of this cult, Grace Hooper Pettifer, to the writer of the book. And my hair prickled. It was as if, having described this coincidence, this synchronicity of Jacques Vallée's as the weirdest one can imagine, fate had said, oh, I'll show you a better one, and produce this within an hour of my writing this. Now, it does seem to me that there are either spirits out there playing jokes on us of that sort, or in some way we induce the synchronicities ourselves. And I'm inclined to think that the second is the true explanation. And that what's more, get yourself into the right state of mind and everything goes okay.
When you talk about all of this, you talk very much from your own point of view, from the sort of insiders. Do you believe that there is anything outside of us that affects anything?
Yes, I mean, the question is, talking from my own point of view about what's inside us, do I believe there's something outside us? Now, the whole point about religion and the reason man's a religious animal is that he could literally feel something outside him. When Van Gogh painted The Starry Night, he got an odd feeling that there really was something out there that was communicating with him. And I think all people in deep religious experiences get that weird feeling that there really is something out there, something, as it were far bigger than they are, far more than their consciousness is able to encompass, but that it really exists out there. Even Shelley, who started his life with a pamphlet on atheism and got chucked out of university for that reason, ended his life by using words like God quite frequently in his last poems, simply because he needed a word to express that peculiar feeling which, as a poet, he had. You've only got to read the Ode to the West Wind to sort of realise that he really felt there was something out there. And that I would define as a religion. I'll take just one more question because I want a sandwich.
A lot of what you've said sounds very sensible, the mental concentration. But it does seem to be quite wholly mental. When I think of ancient man, I think of a creature which isn't like us, fairly sedentary. I think of a very physically active man. And it seems to me, lacking from your theories, a sense of physical drive. See, but I wouldn't call it a peak experience, but I would find that I found myself most happy and most forceful, most absent of questions when I've been doing something like going for a run in the morning, and I've had all sorts of marvellous ideas in that sort of experience.
Yeah.
So what would you say about that? I mean, as opposed to purely mental concentration, it seems to me almost like it's a way of, because you're talking about feeling something out there, which is what you just said. The best way to feel something out there is to get out there and do something with yourself physically.
But then, even Mr. Brownrigg telling me, pull faces, use the face as the gearbox of the soul, was saying, don't just sit thinking, actually do something physical. In point of fact, I found that as soon as I begin to induce peak experiences, I instantly experience a desire to stop stretching my muscles and causing a sort of energy to ripple through me. It automatically induces a need to start doing physical things. The German philosopher Fichte believed that what had gone wrong with philosophy from Kant onwards was simply that it had become so intellectualized that it had lost touch with action, and that this is all that had gone wrong, a kind of indigestion due to lack of action. And Fichte brought that back into philosophy. Now, I've always felt that he was absolutely right. That's why, for example, I've never really, in spite of the fact that I'm not a sportsman in any way, condemned sport. It seems to me a very important way to understanding what you have inside you. Okay?
Well, thank you very much.